I don't think they're, I don't even want to compare them. I don't think there's anybody who's really done more to try to see what we could do at both the local and statewide level to improve Philadelphia's situation. I do want to mention Senator Vince Hughes, who could not be here today, but has played such a vital role, and Senator Nikhil Saval, who wanted to be here, but is doing what any good parent does, which is making sure that his family is safe and sound and well cared for. I also want to tip my hat to our upstate brother in the Senate, and that is Senator Costa. There's many others I could recognize, but these are all people who work all day, every day, to try to improve things for Philadelphia, both in terms of enforcement and prevention. As you may know, there has been a community out there very vested in the prevention of crime. They have, among other things, been interested in an idea that was first published in the Inquirer, or at least the basis for it came in the Inquirer, referred to as 57 blocks. I don't know exactly what these two leaders are going to tell us, but I know it's going to be important, and therefore I call forward Sheriff Bilal and Senator Street.
Good afternoon. On behalf of the Philadelphia Sheriff's Office, we give our sincere condolences to the families, the victims of this senseless mass murder. With that, we are even more concerned over disturbing messages found on the assailant's social media page. Let me congratulate those Philadelphia police officers and the Philadelphia department, my colleagues, who did a superb job in making sure that assailant was captured. We don't have to put a warrant out for that one. That one's in custody, and I want to thank them for the work that they've done. Let us use this opportunity to re-examine social media posts. We may see that mentions harming someone or suggest extreme activities. If you know this person or see a post that raises a red flag, you have to speak up and call the authorities immediately. This is our business, and we can't afford to stay silent. They are letting people know what they are about to do, and that is on all of us to not sit silent when you see these type of posters that is threatening to harm us, harm our communities, harm our children, harm somebody in society. We have to take a part in this. As the investigation continues, we ask for the community's assistance to call and report suspicious activity, unlawful gun purchase, and anything that poses a threat to you and your family. We need your help.
Thank you, Sheriff, District Attorney, all those who've worked on this. 2 years ago on this day, on July 5th, 2021, I was standing here because there had been a mass shooting on July 4th, 2021, in which Saladin Mahmoud Lala, our nephew, was killed. Standing here, full of cameras, shooting on 60th Street, not on 58th, two blocks away. And my wife was burst into tears, and for the first time ever, I burst into tears on camera. Since then, the Pennsylvania General Assembly has failed to enact fit, responsible gun laws. You can still buy an AR-15, which was used in countless murders over and over again. We still haven't passed background checks. The House passed it, but my colleagues, Republican colleagues, make us be clear, in the Senate still have not called that to a vote. The reporting of lost and stolen handguns still is not available, which only targets straw purchasers, does nothing to individual. Red flag laws, safe storage, I could go on. It is absolutely ridiculous. And the only thing that could have made sitting there and looking at this worse was then I watched the mayor of Baltimore talk about the fact that there was a mass shooting there and that almost all of the guns used in mass shootings in Baltimore are purchased out of state. And I guess what? About a significant portion of those were also purchased in Pennsylvania. And I realized our failings in the General Assembly are probably not just responsible for mass shootings here in Philadelphia and throughout the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania, but also responsible for shootings in all the states around us that have more, that have stricter gun laws. And what have we done recently? But the one thing that we had started to do was fund violence prevention groups, something that has in a very modest way start to erode the crime prevention, the what's going on. And we passed a budget out of the Senate that cut violence prevention dollars $65 million below what the governor proposed and what we did last year. It is an absolute atrocity. The budget process isn't done in Harrisburg. And I'm saying this as a family member of someone who died, who can understand what folks are going on. It is an absolute outrage that we would be advancing a budget that cuts violence prevention dollars while we do nothing about the flow of illegal guns, while mass shootings continue to move forward. I said when I stood in front of you, when it was my family member that was laying dead, along among others, was not the only person killed that day, unfortunately. I said, we're standing in a church. People always offer their thoughts and prayers. The book of James says, faith without works are dead. And to my colleagues across in the General Assembly and in Congress who want to offer faith and prayers to the victims of families and do nothing about the problem, to you I say, your faith is dead if you will not do the work to deal with the issues. The victims of families want to see us do something, not just give empty promises and fake prayers.
Thank you so much, Sheriff, and thank you for your passionate words, Senator Street. It is now my opportunity and pleasure to call up ADA Joanne Pescator, the Chief of the Homicide Non-Fatal Shooting Unit, who supervises ADA Bob Wainwright, the prosecutor who has had this case from the beginning, and I expect will have this case until the end. They will be providing specific information about the case. If you have any questions, please hold them. We are going to make sure that you all have an opportunity to ask questions when we get to the question and answer phase. There will be a couple speakers speaking together after ADA Pescator and Bob Wainwright, so I appreciate your patience.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Bob Wainwright. I'm the Assistant District Attorney assigned to the case.
Good afternoon, Joanne Pescator. I am the Chief of the Homicide Non-Fatal Shooting Unit in the Philadelphia District Attorney's Office.
And I just want to start off by stating what others before me have said. My condolences go out to the families of the five murder victims. Lashid Merritt, who was 20, Dimir Stanton, who was 29, Ralph Morales, who was 59, DeJean Brown, who was only 15, and Joseph Wama Jr., who was 31. I also like to send my condolences to the family members who were hurt and survived. Ms. Brown, Octavia Brown, who was driving in a car with three of her children. She suffered a serious injury to her eye from glass. Her twin boys in the back seat, one of them suffered injury from the glass, and the other suffered gunshot wounds to his leg. And her 10-year-old daughter, who was not struck, thankfully, but was in the passenger seat next to her, as well as the surviving complainant, the one person who was struck by bullets, who was not in that car, who survived, who was only 13 years old. I'll just, the defendant in this case had an AR-15 assault rifle. And as it's been said already, I mean, the police work on this case was just absolutely incredible from the very beginning. The fact that they cornered this defendant before he could take more lives is absolutely remarkable and showed incredible bravery by the police officers. And then I got a phone call from ADA Pescator, my boss, shortly after the incident, saying that this was going to be coming down the pipeline and to just be ready. And then I got a phone call later that night, after midnight, by Detective Scally, who's not the assigned, but Detective Scally is an amazing detective in Philadelphia, and he was drafting the search warrants both for the defendant's home and also the home of the Joseph Wama, who had been found after the other four decedents had been already found and the scene had been processed. And then the assigned detective, Detective Orlando Ortiz, who I've had the fortune of working with before, who's an amazing detective as well. And I just am thankful that we've got such great detectives and police in the city.
All right, thank you very much. Obviously, both ADA Wainwright and ADA Pescatore will be available for questions. They may not be able to answer all of them, but they will certainly be able to answer some of those questions. Finally, we have with us to speak together Josephine Wama and Jasmine Wama, who are the sisters of Joseph Wama, one of the murder victims in this case. Josephine is the twin sister of Joseph Wama, and Jasmine is also their sister. I would ask you, please, to understand the sensitivity of the situation and the respect that is something I know you will all convey in dealing with them. Josephine Wama and Jasmine Wama.
Please join the conversation. Put your comments and suggestions below in the comments section. Thank you for subscribing to this news channel. You will be notified of any breaking news and new post as you become part and parcel of the MCAD TV family. Please like and share MCAD TV. We love you all. Please support MCAD TV Foundation by joining membership and visiting Amazon UK to purchase the displayed books to aid our orphanage projects across Africa.